Hi, my name is Brian Robertson. I'm the Quantitative Financial Markets Advisor here at the Atlanta Fed. I'm joined today by two Bitcoin and blockchain experts, Warren Weber, who is visiting scholar here at the Atlanta Fed, and Sudheer Chava, Professor of Finance at the Georgia Institute of Technology. Gentlemen, thank you for joining me today.
Thank you. Pleasure.
So we heard two sessions today about blockchain, and we've covered quite a bit of ground. Overall, though, how do you think the sessions went?
Well, I think the sessions went extremely well. For people who didn't know much about blockchains, cryptocurrencies, digital currencies, I think they got a tremendous introduction from some people who really know what is going on, who've worked in the industry, and have been doing a lot of deep thinking about the issues that surround them, the advantages, the disadvantages.
Thank you, Brian. I enjoyed the sessions a lot. I think I've been teaching a class on fintech for around 5-6 years, but attending the sessions, I actually got new perspectives, some of which I haven't thought about. For example, Eric's session on the limits of Bitcoin and how we formalize that, and there's a new insight, I think, which I haven't thought about. So they're very interesting and very informative.
The first session this morning talked about the advantages or potential advantages we could see from these blockchain and Bitcoin-style technologies, whereas the second session focused solely on the Bitcoin technology itself. It seemed that there was a bit of a distinction between the two in that there are these permissioned blockchains versus permissionless blockchains, and I was just wondering if you guys might be able to provide some insight on what that distinction is and how we might understand and why that's important.
So I think most of the attention has been, I think, or at least the original purpose of Bitcoin, I think, and the blockchain, I think, came out of the technology which is behind the Bitcoin. The initial phase, I think, people looked at Bitcoin, and then afterwards people thought about the blockchain, the real innovation behind that. And it's a public blockchain. So one way to think about it is a database system where I think there's an open read and write. So everyone could write into this one, as compared to a traditional database system where there's a limited set of actors which do that. Whereas the permission blockchain, I think, is again gets back to like a more limited database where there's players which might be centralized parties or there might be trusted parties which can actually have the right permissions. So it might be, for example, in the context of Wall Street, it might be DTCC which might actually do that. So there's a permission within another way to think about it is it's a limited ecosystem. Who gets into the system is limited in a permission blockchain, whereas the permissionless or the open blockchain, which is underpins the Bitcoin, I think it's anyone can enter into the ecosystem. So that's one way to think about. But both the idea is, I think, both there's immutability in it, and there's, again, some advantages and disadvantages.
I think the one part I took away from the presentation this morning is that the so-called permission blockchains are really no different from the usual information management, data management systems. Maybe there's a little difference in how everything is organized, but really they're all require, you know, some kind of trusted third-party agent to be involved in that. Whereas the whole idea of the permissionless blockchain, and there are many of them out there. There's not just the Bitcoin blockchain. I think there's maybe too much focus just on the Bitcoin blockchain, but that's just my personal opinion. But the permissionless blockchain is really about trying to get trust in something where there's no sort of trusted third party involved in that. And all of the discussion in the second session was about one method of trying to do that, which is called proof of work. And proof of work is very expensive, it's very costly, and it was very good to get for the discussion to bring out how costly it really is to generate trust there. Whereas if you have a permissioned blockchain, you sort of have the trust because you have the trusted third party right there at the beginning.
So again, we covered a lot of ground between these two sessions. With these distinctions in mind, what do you feel like are the key points that we might want to take away from either the sessions overall or from one session in particular? What do you think was kind of the golden nugget?
I think there were several golden nuggets that came out. The first one came out in the first session was, don't think that just because it's on a blockchain and I don't care if it's permissioned or permissionless, that it's somehow trusted, because it's data being entered, and so you have to trust the entering of the data, okay? And so there's that first level of trust before you get to the actual trust of the accounting system itself. The other thing that came out, and I'm not sure where we ended up in the discussion, was about whether or not the immutability of the Bitcoin blockchain or the permissionless blockchain is actually good or bad. Are there circumstances in which you might want to change things? For example, if somebody hacked a particular block in a particular way, would you want to undo that, and can you undo it? The other thing that I think was interesting was the discussion about regulation and the fact that current regulation, especially around things like blockchains, really reflects maybe more what was going on in the 1930s or 1940s rather than the realities of today, and maybe regulatory agencies ought to be rethinking how they regulate this particular area.
Yeah, there's a lot of interesting insights that came about, and I think some of which I've been thinking for some time, and many new perspectives which I haven't thought about. But the first thing, I guess, is in terms of even regulators, I think trying to stay ahead of it. And I think it's a very nice thing, I think, with these innovations. I think it's always run ahead of regulators. So I think it's important that the regulators are, I think, ahead of them, or I think following that and trying to like incorporate them. That's one. The second thing, I guess, is in terms of the blockchain, or I think Bitcoin, or other innovations, a healthy dose of skepticism. I think it's important to think about this real financial innovation. There's a huge potential. I think that's what I think many people in the industry are motivated by. But there might be some cause for skepticism also. I think that's one thing which I took away. Another way of thinking about is an often attributed quote, I guess, to Bill Gates is, we always overestimate what can happen in the next 2 years and underestimate what can happen in 10 years. So I think about blockchain in that context. There's a lot of hype and a lot of energy, but which is going to change. Many people in the industry think it's going to change the world in the next few years. That I'm not sure about, but there might be improvements and there might be more technological innovations which can make it a better tool, maybe going forward. And the third, I think, I guess, is in the current context, some of the limitations of Bitcoin or even blockchains which are pointed out. One is many companies, if you have this proof of concepts or other implementations, where one is trying to impose this blockchain on the existing processes, I think that's a big issue. Because just by putting, as one somebody has pointed out, garbage in into a system, I think, again, it's garbage out. Or another way of thinking about is if your existing systems are not optimized, that is, you just basically impose the blockchain on existing system, existing set of process, then it's going to be very inefficient, and it actually might not scale well and might do much worse. So the way out is probably just going back to the drawing board and going through the system and saying, what are the processes? Where is value being added? Where is efficiency can come from a blockchain? Which ones do I want to put in a blockchain? Which ones don't I want to? Which data do I need? How does it scale? Is it appropriate for this particular situation? Is it a solution in such of a problem, or a problem in such of a solution? So I think to think about these broad issues, and I think this kind of a healthy discussion, I think where this people see the potential, but also the issues, so that they can be addressed in the future, I think would be very interesting.
I think you made a great point, which is one of the panelists this morning said, when you're thinking about this, think of what the problem is that needs to be solved or that you're wanting to solve, and that the blockchain may not be the solution to every problem that's out there.
Were there any issues that you are aware of around this field that perhaps you didn't get a chance to talk about here today?
Well, the one issue that sort of came up, but this is a session on sort of financial institutions, but there's the more general issue of how a blockchain can be used to help people create their identity, who they are, what they've done, and the potential for, if you can get stronger identities, what that could do in terms of unlocking the possibilities for people getting credit and what that could do for standard of living across the world.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. I think in terms of both the financial inclusion, I think where there's a segment of population, even in the US, I think where there's 20-25% which is underbanked, and I think which partly, like I think, which relies on identity, can blockchain be used for an immutable identity record? I think that's interesting. There's some work being done in that area, but I think a lot more needs to be done. Again, all the issues with the security will come in, all the issues with blockchain, I think, would come into that issue. But I think it's a great point, because if it can work, identity, I think that's the key to like financial inclusion. I think that would be great. I think we haven't talked about as much about what's the initial coin offerings and some others, because probably the time has passed for that. Last year, I think there was the...
That was the big year.
Many of them, I think, failed. I think there's a lot of scams, and I think
if you read the white papers, some of them sound like what are you trying to do?
Right, and some of them actually are the straight copy of other white papers, and I have actually
And I have
a PhD student who's actually looking at research in the ICOs. So I think, in general, I think tokens, the token economics, I think, and that I think is interesting. I think, that's it.
Now, and to go back to the identity thing, you know, this is, again, if you're entering things like records, like marriage records or birth certificates, things like that, do you trust the person who's entering them? Or think about, you know, tokenizing mortgages. Do you trust the person who's entering the mortgage or someone who is doing the title search? Do you trust all the entries that they're looking through? So, I think one of the things I really took away is the first level of trust is the entering of the data. Just because it's data doesn't mean it's trustworthy.
Right. No.
Anyway.
I think there's one more point, which probably hasn't been covered as much, but I think which might be very interesting is from a privacy angle. I think in a blockchain, I think this again, people are thinking about differential privacy. So I think when all the information is out there, when everyone can read it, how do you maintain privacy? I think that's, there's ways of doing it, I think, but I think that's another interesting angle, privacy and ethics of it, I think. That's something which I think would be nice to see.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, and, you know, from my perspective, you know, one of the things that we didn't really get a chance to broach is this notion of, okay, so we have data on a ledger, and that represents something that could potentially represent something physical. Just because I trade the data on it on an exchange or through a ledger doesn't mean that asset actually gets transferred from one party to the next. And so how does that get facilitated? How does that get done in a way that is in a trustworthy process, not unlike what we see? You know, think about buying a home. You know, just because you've transferred the funds for it doesn't mean you actually receive the title. And so how do we make sure that sort of thing happens? And so there's a lot of ground to cover in this topic. It's an exciting field to research from my end and to talk about with these gentlemen here today. I thank everyone for viewing in. We'll be doing other interviews throughout the conference, so make sure to check those out. Again, Brian Robertson, Quantitative Financial Markets Advisor here at the Financial Markets Conference in Amelia Island, Florida. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.